Only recently have we begun to wonder about the minds of these awesome yet supremely graceful beings who have roamed the seas for millions of years before man's evolution. Having gained a position of dominance on this planet, we are discovering that we are not the center of life, but merely an element of an intricate ecosystem where each form of life is interdependent. In our need to justify our exploitation of all non-human life forms, we have conjured up a belief system which denies these creatures feelings, imagination, and awareness. Yet the whales have brains that exceed ours in size and in areas that are known to function in thinking, perception, memory, and conceptual thought. That there is an intelligence of another order on Earth, in the oceans, is now beginning to inspire those who have not been blinded by the traditional way of viewing nature. But the whales are vanishing. Since the 1920s, more than 2 million whales have been killed by commercial hunters, bringing 5 of the 10 species of great whales to the threshold of extinction. The whales were processed for use in the manufacture of commercial lubricants, fertilizers, mink feed, cooking fat compounds, pet foods, pharmaceutics, dynamite, crayons, soaps, and cosmetics. The Second World War offered a brief reprieve for the whales, as man turned his attention from killing whales to concentrate on the destruction of his own kind. Many whaling ships were converted to military use and destroyed in battle. 28 factory ships, including all of the Japanese boats, finished the war as battered hulks on the bottom of the seas.
Japan's whaling fleet, by permission of General MacArthur's administration, is on the move again in the Antarctic. England, Norway, and Australia have protested, but American officials consider it an economic necessity. Fire she blows, or whatever it is the Japs say. Anyway, a whale's been spotted and the harpoon gunner gets set. Ready, aim, fire! End of Moby Dick. A special flag marks his carcass as the whalers go after another monster. The 100-pound harpoon is a wicked weapon. Its head explodes on impact with the whale, anchoring sharp-pointed barbs in its hide. Yards of rope are drawn out in the wounded giant's death struggle. The whale hunt will help alleviate Japan's food shortage and ultimately save over $20 million for American taxpayers. Aboard the mothership, the whale is flensed or stripped of blubber. After its thick coat of fat is slit open, steam winches rip it off. Besides providing edible fats, blubber is used in making soap and fertilizer. Obviously, there's more to whaling than meets the eye. Last of all, much of the valuable catch is salted and packed as whale fillets for the long journey home. Not exactly porterhouse steak, but mighty welcome to a hungry nation.
Representatives of 14 whaling nations formed the International Whaling Commission in 1946 to regulate the orderly development of the whaling industry. Each June, the IWC meets in London, in this modern concrete high-rise, to determine the fate of the last great whales. With an air of sophistication and civility, the delegates politely sit down together to carve up the whale pie. Today, the large pelagic whaling fleets are operated only by Russia and Japan, who together are responsible for more than 80% of the world's whale catch. The Japanese whaling industry argues that Japan needs whale meat to feed her protein-poor nation. However, the majority of whales killed are sperm whales, which are not eaten by anyone. The logic behind this destruction is purely economic. Extermination of the last whales will provide the maximum return on investment. Since the fleets are nearing retirement and their replacement is not a practical consideration, the whalers have decided to take as many whales as possible during the ensuing few seasons and are fully aware of the consequences. The IWC has been little more than a front for the whaling companies. Mr. Iwao Fujita, Japan's delegate, is also a director of a major whaling company. So to expect the IWC to protect whales is like asking the wolves to guard the sheep. The IWC has no powers of enforcement. Any member nation can exempt itself from any restriction merely by making a formal protest. The commission has consistently set catch quotas which are even larger than the number the whalers are able to catch. The recommendations of its scientific committee are seldom adhered to. In 1949, the commission was informed that the blue whales were in serious decline. But it took the IWC until 1967, 18 years later, to finally act upon these warnings. Now the blue whales, the largest creatures in the world, are so close to extinction that their recovery is in doubt. At the 1974 meeting of the IWC, the Mexican delegate made a final statement that if a 10-year moratorium was not introduced soon, this commission will be known to history as a small body of men who failed to act responsibly in the terms of a very large commitment to the world and who protected the interest of a few whalers and not the future of thousands of whales.
Well, by about 1975 in January, it was pretty clear that the situation in terms of the survival of the whales had gone so badly downhill. No government seemed able to do anything about it. Various conservation groups had been powerless to stop it. So we decided what we needed was a workable plan. And the only workable plan we were able to come up with was to take a boat and go right out in the ocean and, against whatever odds we had to face, find a whaling fleet. And then we would take some inflatable rubber boats with outboard engines called Zodiacs and put people in them and then drive out right in front of the harpoon so that the harpooner wouldn't have a shot at the whale without having to go through or blast apart that human shield that had finally gotten up and got in the way and said, no, it's time to stop. The man who came forward to get us out on the Pacific was John C. Cormack, a veteran who's been up and down the West Coast longer than most of the people on the crew had been alive. And we had worked with him before trying to stop nuclear tests in the Pacific. So we knew John's judgment. We knew he was one of the real living old sea lions of the West Coast. And if anybody could get us out there and find the fleets, it would be John. A younger but equally essential crew member was a Czechoslovakian named George Kurotva, who was experienced both as a seaman, a captain in his own right, and as a radio operator. In addition, he'd been arrested in Czechoslovakia during the uprising and taken by the Russians and put in a Siberian camp for several years before he escaped. And during that time, he learned to speak fluent Russian, so that if we intercepted the Russians, at least we would have someone on board who could tell them what we were going to do.
Drop the boat! There's no objection. If somebody falls to the water, second person jump to the outboard and cut the propeller off.
Yeah. See that point, the far point there, and the dark right there.
That far point.
The far point is Kane's Island Light, yeah.
And that's the open sea.
Yeah.
Okay, I would like to go there too.
There,
yeah, did you check how much gas do you have?
Yeah, okay, I got it.
You got enough?
We got lots.
Okay, so let's go there.
The first thing we did was take everybody out who was going to be on the voyage, and they were a green crew, and break them in. So to do this, we started off by conducting a series of very grueling Zodiac exercises. Former whalers had warned us that in addition to the danger of the obvious danger of being blown apart by a 250-pound explosive harpoon and the danger of being run down or swamped by one of these large factory ships or killer boats, there was also the very real danger that a wounded whale might decide to attack us simply because it couldn't get at the larger whaling boats. So there were all those risks to consider.
Yeah!
left Vancouver, British Columbia on the 27th of April, 1975. 23,000 people came out to show their support.
Three cheers for Greenpeace. You ready?
Sailing, they're crazy as hell. They'd be riding the big ocean in a hollowed out shell. They'll probably get seasick, or they'll probably go blind. They're probably on drugs, or at least out of their minds. Now what is a whale but a big hunk of flesh? Let's poke him, stab him, steal his breath. Let's shoot him, let's waste him, let's blood up the sea. Till there's none of them left in the whole world to see.
From the log of the Greenpeace 5, May 3, 1975. We have now spent several days searching for the whaling fleets along the coast of British Columbia, following the advice of old fishermen who used to see the whalers out here in the past. We have been monitoring our radio day and night, hoping to pick up radio transmission from the whaling boats. Our crew is working out well enough, although some have been confined to their bunks recovering from seasickness. The ship's doctor reports that they are all expected to make the adjustment to life on board in the next few days.
Come, fellows, let's get on some big fancy ship and chase all them whales, there's money in this. Come on, boys, let's get 'em, let's dry up the sea. They're made to be taken like women and trees.
From the ship's log, June the 2nd, 1975. We have now been searching for over a month, covering virtually all the positions where we expected to find the fleets. The ocean is far vaster than most of us had ever dreamed. Today, we came across an abandoned whaling station at a place called Rose Harbor in the Queen Charlotte Islands. The ruins here form a grim reminder that for the coastal whales, at any rate, we have come too late. One of the objectives of the expedition was to establish communication with the whales in their own environment. We had no idea how the whales would react. We could understand that from the whales' point of view, we're the same creatures that have been coming out after them in boats year after year for centuries, carrying spears and harpoons with anything but friendly intentions. From the ship's log, June 13th, 1975. Information sent to us from overseas anti-whaling intelligence sources have provided exact positions of the fleets during previous years. If the patterns are repeated this year, the Japanese will now be at least 2,000 miles away in the mid-Pacific, but the Soviet fleet will be due south of us, just off the coast of Mendocino, California. The problem is the time is running out. Our strategy all along was to have a confrontation with the whalers before the IWC meeting, bringing as much pressure as possible to bear on them. We are now heading south as fast as we can.
All the Greenpeace is sailing, they're as crazy as hell. They'll be dodging harpoons and dancing on swells. They go to save whales, at least that's what they said. Those folks will be lucky they don't come back dead.
From the ship's log, June 23rd, our fourth day in the waters off Mendocino and still no sign of the whalers. We've run out of canned juice, coffee, vegetables, bread. Water is on ration and nobody's been able to wash except in salt water. If we don't find the whalers soon, all the money and support from thousands of people will have been for nothing. Crew morale is deteriorating badly. We know the IWC meeting starts today in London.
Vancouver, do you read?
The Russians continue to elude us. It's clear now that if we're going to find them, we're going to need more information and assistance. Many of the crew are now physically exhausted, and our only means of communication with the outside world is Captain John's 25-year-old radio phone.
Vancouver calling the Phyllis Cormack. Could you repeat the number again, please?
980-4049.
Thank you, that's 980-4049.
980-4049.
Thank you, 980-4049.
That's correct, Vancouver.
And that to save the whales, we've got to get rid of the IWC and replace it by a body that's truly international. And is represented more than just by countries with a commercial interest in whales.
But haven't they in fact done quite a lot to save whales so far?
Well, they've always done it too little and always too late. As a result, they've had to protect completely species after species, and some of them aren't recovering. They've usually protected them when it's no longer commercially feasible to exploit them anyhow, so that it looks good, but it isn't.
If you cannot hear me, can you tell us what news? What is happening? Over.
I can't hear you at all, Bob.
Okay, I'll have to try it. 5 o'clock or 5:30.
I still read you loud and clear. Can you give us a report? Can you give us a report? I read you loud and clear. Just talk to us. We can hear you. Over.
Well, I'm against whaling because of the way in which whaling has been conducted. Too many whales have been taken in too short a time to allow the whales' populations to recover. And this is bad resource management and is no good for the whales and no good for the people hunting them.
what is your reaction to the Japanese whale whaling?
Well, my reaction is that I believe it's reprehensible in that it's silly way. It's a silly way of treating a resource, but at the same time, it's commercially stupid.
Hello? I'll put Gary on the line, Bob.
Roger, 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 roger.
I can read you, Gary. Do you have anything to report? Just please report. Over.
Bob, there is an aircraft flight, an organized aircraft flight, Oregon to Mexico along the coast. We can get information from that.
Russian voices on the radio. A fix on the radio directional finder shows their position about 60 miles off the coast. Captain John alters our course immediately, bearing closer to land, and cranks her up to full throttle.
Okay, all hands on deck!
1, 2, 3, 4, 5 over there. There's one by the Vostok, and there's three over here. There's 9 chasers all together.
The Zodiacs are all ready. All we need is launchers.
9 chasers.
The chaser boats are working looks like a circular search pattern, with two of them moving off to the east of us, one moving northward directly ahead, and then some others more or less in the middle. The Vostok is dead ahead, and it seems to have at least one or two boats up beside it, which means they may be hauling whales in. So we're taking a course straight for the Vostok. Everybody is in their wetsuits. We've worked out who's going to be in what Zodiacs. There's a fairly, it was a moderate chop, which isn't too good for the Zodiacs, but very good light. 12:20, John has just spotted two flags in the water, which probably means whales that have been hit. So we've changed course and we're heading straight for that. They're dead ahead of us, I can see it too. Yeah, here is it. Definitely a dead whale. Bleeding like... just bleeding all over the place. Can't tell at the moment whether it's a fin. I would say it's a fin, but you can't tell just yet.
It's a sperm!
It's a sperm.
It's too small, Bob.
It's definitely a sperm. Can't be much more than 20 feet.
Just a film thing, so let's get a Zodiac and circle around this whale and get some shots.
Sure doesn't look all right.
I noticed one of the killer boats about a mile off now is coming back towards us.
I think we should even measure that one.
What do you say, Paul? How long do you think it is? How long?
About 18 feet.
The whale measured 24 feet, which is 6 feet under the minimum legal size set by the International Whaling Commission itself.
Hey, watch yourselves! Watch yourselves!
Come on! Guys, I got a water hose!
Got a hose.
Oh, that's
nothing.
Well, Rex?
Hey, can we get
her? I got a water hose. Watch your gear.
Maybe we could turn ours on.
Doesn't look like much of a boat. Like hell, we could do anything.
Sure.
Anybody's writing their name down?
We followed the killer boat back to its the huge Delnay Vostok. This is a 600-foot floating slaughterhouse capable of processing an entire whale in less than half an hour. Most of the whales appeared to be small, somewhere between 25 to 35 feet long, and certainly nothing like the 80 or 90-foot giants that Herman Melville was talking about in Moby Dick. As we came downwind, some of our crew were overcome by the stink and had to go to the side of the boat. Having worked in a slaughterhouse myself years before, I immediately recognized that smell. It was the same smell that would come from butchered cattle, or for that matter, from human beings.
Vostok. We are Canadiensky.
Hello, Vostok. We are Canadian.
Ми не любим охотку на китовцов. Знаєш, то это так зробите.
We don't want you to kill the whales. Why must you do it?
What did you say to
them? You told them it's no good what they're doing, and they said go to hell.
Once they understood that we were here to save whales, the Russians ignored us completely, going back to business as usual. We were left with no alternative but to carry out our pledge to use our bodies as shields to protect the whales. So we picked out a killer ship and stayed with it as it set out on a new hunt.
They were running from us there, John?
No, they're not running from us. They're looking for whales. See, they're going around in this big circle here. They're not running from us.
We must be right on the ground, sir.
Okay, Zodiac launching crew.
Zodiac launching crew.
Go
on, quick.
Okay. Jesus, Rick,
Okay.
It's all
yours.
Okay.
Ready?
Yes. You're holding the end over the rope.
Yes.
We got to the point where I was afraid we were going to overrun the whales. You could see the shoulder with the blowhole come right out of the water. And then we could see the guy crouching, getting ready to shoot. The only rule we kept was every time they pointed the gun another way, we'd swivel in front of that. And we came up on one wave, and there he was, and we were looking right in the... I thought we were had a plug, like couldn't possibly shoot. Then we went down, and then that fantastic sound, and you could hear the of the cable. I guess we both ducked at that point, and I don't know what happened.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed a pleasure for me to welcome you to the 27th annual meeting of the International Whaling Commission in London again. Since my predecessor addressed you a year ago when he opened the 26th meeting, the Commission has taken further important steps towards the conservation of the world's wild stocks. Your agenda is impressively long, as you may be well aware. The United Kingdom government welcomes this proposal for the classification of stocks as a significant step forward in the rational management of the various whale stocks of the oceans. The recognition of stock differences is also the essential theme of another important advance which the Commission has agreed, which will enable more confident degrees of what I call fine-tuning in the control of these stocks.
Can I have you up here just a bit, Wayne?
Up here.
Just come on up the ladder.
And we explained who we were, that we were the Greenpeace Foundation from British Columbia, Canada, and we represented the groups in North America who were, and in the world, who were opposed to the continued slaughter of whales in the oceans.
When he shot, and the harpoon went 15 feet over Hunter and George's head, and then the line snapped in the water 5 feet from their boat. It would have ripped their boat in half if it had hit him.
My name is George Korotua. I'm born in Czechoslovakian, but now I'm Canadian citizen.
George, could you explain the incident when the Russians fired the harpoon over your head?
Well, from the beginning, I didn't believe they would do it.
The killer ship was coming down on a pod of about 9 whales. We positioned ourselves right in front of the harpoon. George was over the controls, and I was sitting at the front, keeping my eye on the harpooner. Whales were breaking the surface all around us. Then one whale came up, a female, gasping for breath. I could see the harpooner tensing, so I knew he was going to fire. There was a roar like a giant firecracker, and George and I just both automatically ducked. And then the whale was hit. I heard the harpoon exploding inside her. The cable came slashing down in the water, just missing us by about 4 feet. The whale was writhing in front of us, spouting blood. And at this point, the Russians immediately stopped the hunt, and we could see the other 8 whales making their escape.
Okay, car spinning! Spin it up on him, put it on the auto.
Greenpeace is still sailing, they're crazy, that's it. The thing that they're sailing is a great battleship. Them whalers blood hungry, they're out to get rich. Greenpeace is still sailing, and Greenpeace won't quit.
The James Bay, a 153-foot converted Canadian Navy minesweeper, renamed the Greenpeace 7, has the capability of traveling 21 knots, which is faster than any whale-killing boat. Our strategy this year is to head right down to the California coast and rendezvous with our second vessel, the Phyllis Cormac, with her American crew, on the same date and at precisely the point where the incident had taken place the previous year. An average of 1,300 sperm whales have been killed annually within 700 miles of the west coast of North America. When our intelligence sources came up with the positions of the fleets this year, we received the first tangible evidence of our impact on the whalers. There is no fleet within 800 miles of the coast. So for the first time since the Second World War, whales can migrate along the North American coast without risk of being butchered. With the coast secured, our next move is to head out after the fleets in the very deepest part of the Pacific Ocean. We intercepted the Russian fleet just after it had finished killing off a pod of whales.
All slack!
Our photographers are sent out to document what's happened. As a safety precaution, we have equipped each Zodiac with a radio. At this point, we were unaware of the circumstances that would soon place all of their lives in danger.
But we don't see you, you don't have radar reflectors. If you get lost, we never pick you up.
We can still see you, George.
God damn it, no radar reflectors.
We're coming up alongside the killer boat, so just picking up the dead one around.
Do you still see us? Over.
What?
I'm not reading you, Susie. Over.
Just a minute.
Heading towards them, lines?
Yeah. No, we cannot see you at the present moment.
Okay, now hang on. We don't know where you are. Okay, we're moving the boat forward, we think, towards you. So keep an eye open, and the moment you see us, let us know. Over.
Roger. We're right up alongside the kill boat.
We're going to blow the horn, and tell us if you hear us loud and clear. Over. Did you hear the horn?
No, I can't hear it.
Okey-doke. Now listen. Okay, if you can't hear that horn, then you better stop for a second. And we better stop for a second, and we're going to figure this one out. But that means we've lost contact with you, and we do not know which radar blip you're on. So call off whatever operation you're doing right now and stand still. Over.
Okay. Hey, do you see this killer boat? It's just leaving now. It should be steaming. We're right up beside it.
Stick with the killer boat.
Okay, second. Hey, hang on a second. Stick with that killer boat, because at least we can track the killer boats. Over.
If you can see that boat moving, we'll just pull over into the horse truck. Roger
that? Roger. Okay. Can you signal to the people in the other Zodiac? Over.
And send that guy. Yeah. Towards the killer boats. Scout for them.
Yeah. Okay, we're going to try the foghorn. One loud blast. Okay, over. Did you hear anything at all? Oh, did someone
get it?
Please,
I didn't get it.
Shut up, please.
Okay, now listen. We have been running. The other Zodiac is with us now. I can see it here. Now, we have been running with the swell of the sea coming from behind us the whole time. Over.
Where's that kilo? Keep an eye on it. Okay. Do you have any metal objects on the boat which you can put on the oar and stick it up? Over.
Just a minute, George. We'll look into that. Over.
Okay, we're standing by.
Could you try pulling your foghorn, please?
Affirmative. Say again.
Would you please blow your foghorn? We are getting ready to take it out.
Just gave two long blasts on the five horn.
Roger, we heard you wrong.
Do they hear? Say again.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Oh, great. Far out. Far.
We hear you loud and clear.
Low on fuel, Captain Kurodva insists that we resupply at the nearest port, so we head southwest for Honolulu.
Mm-hmm.
2 days ago, Hal here brought us a piece of paper, which was a statement from Coast Guard information stating that Japanese fleet consisting of Koyo, Koyu, Maru number 3, and 7 killer boats had been sighted in vicinity of French frigate Shoals, which is about 580 miles northwest of here.
It looks like they're handing it to us on a platter again. The possibilities are insane right now. In fact, I'm actually half expecting the South African whaling fleet to, for some bizarre reason or other, to appear here. But the fact is, you know, just because someone said a fleet was by some reef 2 days ago or even today, a day or a half or 2 days from now, they may be anywhere. And the reality of it is that with our particular RDF equipment, they don't have to get very far out of range for us to lose them. Our best terms are ones with a high, intense, immediate, instantaneous feedback media profile. It's not a slug-it-out number in the depths of somewhere where no one knows what the hell is going on and we just disappear one night.
At this point, the story, so far as the external world is concerned, is the same story we had 2 days ago, which is we're hitting Russians because that's where our first duty lies. We've got to finish our trip with them.
By 8:30 a.m. Vancouver time this morning, we could finally see the dots on the horizon.
There's a Russian factory ship, I do believe, down in Vostok, about 5 degrees on the port side. I would say about 4 miles from us. And on our starboard side, we so far count 9 kilo boats.
We've been listening in on the radio last night and could hear the Russians, and the skipper had been calling the boats in for a tight formation. Yet this morning when we arrived, the formation scattered and they started moving off in every direction. So we decided first of all to go in for the Vostok. But as we were going in, there was one chaser boat that was fairly close, started moving, and we spotted whales in front of it. And it was closing in on them, so we just stopped the boat really quick and got a Zodiac into the water right away and set out as fast as we could. I think it only took us about 10 minutes to get across there. And when we got up to we started waving to see how they would react, and a lot of the crew members waved back in a quite friendly way, but the officers, as usual, were giving them hell for doing that. So we just did like we did last year. We swung right in front of the harpoon and stayed there, and they were obviously still searching, swinging the harpoon one way or another, and the whales blew a couple of times, but they were still at the early stages of the hunt when the whales could sound quite a while. Now last year it took about an hour for the whole thing to happen, but ending with them shooting the harpoon. But this time,
they swiveled the cannon around, and then finally, they just, I guess they got an order from somewhere, and they stopped, clicked the harpoon up and put the pins in and shut her down, and they've been sitting here ever since. They tried to start up again a couple of times, and then we got back in front of them, and they stopped again. So they're stopped at the moment. We'll see what happens from here.
By this time, our other two Zodiacs had arrived, so we had an odd floating picket line in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, with a Russian chaser boat, whale-killing boat, stopped dead in its tracks. And after about an hour of this, they even put the canvas bag back over the harpoon. And it was obviously that they decided not to shoot at us or over us this time. And so we have stopped one chaser boat already and saved one pod of whales, which is not bad for our first morning's work. We stopped them once, and that means we have the capability of stopping them more and more. Over.
Hello, friends. Excuse me, but please stop killing the whales. Stop killing the whales.
It is discovered that some of the crew aboard the Vostok speak English.
Today we thank you for sparing our lives. That was a humane gesture. It showed respect for human life.
Now, however, we must begin to have respect for other life, for Comrade Dolphin and Comrade Whale, because without them, the oceans begin to die. And if the oceans begin to die, we all begin to die. We've seen the ocean ourselves. There are not many whales left. These whales belong to all the people of the earth. We are asking that you stop for the benefit of your children and grandchildren, as well as ours. We feel no anger towards you. We view you as our brothers and sisters on planet Earth. But we are trying to speak for the Earth. We respect your nation, your revolution, and your history. And now we're asking you, from your position of strength and power, to grant us a small request. Please stop killing the whales. We are men and women, and we speak for children, and we're all saying, please stop killing the whales.
Yet, despite the efforts of Greenpeace, the slaughter of whales continued. The strategy of non-violent confrontation carried out by a single vessel, no matter how effective, has obvious physical limitations in protecting all the whales in all the oceans of the world.
We kept up our harassment over a distance of 1,700 miles. Each time contact was made, the whalers responded by shutting down their operation. They would not leave dead whales floating in the water, and they would not kill whales in front of our cameras. So the camera proved to be mightier than the harpoon. The fleet finally attempted to evade us, but we stayed right with them, keeping up the pressure as long as we could. The Vostok and its 9 killer boats were forced to steam far faster and further than usual, making their entire whale-killing operation less efficient and costing them dearly in additional fuel consumption. The final score, 100 whales saved by direct confrontation, 1,300 other whales protected from the threat of being slaughtered off the coast of North America, and a Soviet fleet forced to waste time and money trying to evade Greenpeace.
Holiness of morning, I love you through sad eyes. Though you be a perfect ending for the darkened skies, cloud formations move to prove there is no form that stays. Mankind weaves a wayward path, ignoring nature's ways. Oh, we are but the lightning, we're a glimpse of what is wise. In the ocean's holy foam, the whale to breathe must rise. Land all laced with poison is choking on the load. Mankind murders all his friends, he's soon to be alone. Nature wove together an intricate design. We have since unraveled it in all too brief a time. Killing wolves and eagles for living as they must. It's on and on till balance fails as species bite the dust. In my mind I see no rhyme or reason to this maze, and in my heart I feel we are but slaves in many ways. The animals that were our friends before we taught them fear, haven't they a proper right to keep on living here? The epic of the endless seas is drawing to a close. Corporation factory ships deal the final blow, pledging falsely that their plunder serves the people's needs, while the bleeding oceans flow, a monument to greed. Oh, if by chance they ask you for approval of this mess, dear friends, tell them where you stand and do your level best. aid the cause for needed laws, protecting all you see. Let's help to stop the senseless killing on the land and sea. Pray to God it's not too late to set the dolphin free. Pray to God it's not too late to set the dolphin free.